Stitch. I'm Lynn.
And I'm Pam. We're happy you're joining us today. The Stitch is an online quilting talk show. Join us as we talk about current topics in the quilt world, fun projects of our own, and techniques to improve your own projects.
The Stitch comes out twice monthly, complemented by virtual sew-ins and weekly podcasts. Learn more about thestitchtvshow.com.
So today we are taking Ask Us Anything questions from social media and live here at the Chattahoochee Evening Stars, Stars and Stitches Quilt Show. We have a special guest star joining us later after our little break.
I'm so excited about that.
So before we get to our questions, what you've been doing since the last time we talked?
Which was like 30 minutes ago. No, we went, this is very exciting. So Pam and I had the opportunity to go to a new convention that they're doing in the sewing world, and it was called Sew Pro, and it was for sewing professionals, and we got to go up there and learn about how to write patterns, how to get published, how to do social media. We're the only one who had video, though.
That is true.
There were some tutorials,
but we're the only ones that just sit and talk about quilts.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly. But it was great, exciting. You know what was my favorite part? One, I got to meet some of my quilting celebrity, like I got to fangirl a little bit. And Tula Pink was there.
I know.
I love Tula. I've been a fan of Tula Pink's fabric for years.
Yeah.
So it was really fun meeting her. And we did, if you saw our Instagram, we did the fangirl like, oh, look, there's Tula in the background.
Yeah.
So click.
Our friend Ray, who went with us, who works behind the scenes here at The Stitch, she and I had walked over to the Starbucks to get breakfast. And then we're like, well, keynote starts in an hour. Who cares? We're going to go sit down. And so we just walk in the ballroom and we're like, Tula Pink's the only one here. We could be super awkward and not sit at her table. Just sit at her table and maybe not say anything and just make weird eye contact with her, which is,
so
you know, our usual
did.
Plan. Weird eye contact happening with the audience here. So Ray and I were sitting there and Lynn was coming behind because she got breakfast at a different spot, and we're flipping through the magazine that they left on the table for all the attendees. We're like, oh, a Bernina ad for the Tula Pink machine.
There's Tula.
I'm gonna just put this on Instagram.
Yeah, so we were Instagramming Tula.
And what I found funny is, you know, then she got up and gave her keynote, which is fabulous. Always listen to her speak if you get a chance.
She's a great speaker.
And in the middle of her talking, Tula Pink liked our photo. And I'm like, wait a minute, she's on stage.
Her brother's down there liking all the...
She has magical elves.
Yeah.
As you would expect from Tula, magical elves. Just follow her.
Yes, all her animals.
Sprinkle just, color dust
yes,
everywhere.
Exactly.
Oh, amazing. Yeah, yes. But fabulous speaker. Pat Sloan was there.
Sarah Lawson from So Sweetness was there.
Yep.
So got to get some information from her.
Brenda Ratliff from Pink Castle Fabrics.
Oh,
just a ton of people.
It was like crazy.
And
like,
what was funny to me is, you know, we're there and we're meeting people and I'm like,
awkwardly meeting people.
Well, that's how
we're like, should we go up and talk to them? I don't know.
We could just talk to each other.
Hey, we could just, But we did.
Let's just see who else is hashtagging SoPro Convention and maybe we'll see them based on the angle. But I was recognizing people and it was from either their social media handles or it was, oh, I think I know you from the Facebook group for SoPro. And I got a lot of, oh, you're the one that made the color-coded spreadsheet for the schedule. Yes, I am.
Yes.
I made a spreadsheet.
That she sent to me and told me what to go to.
I did.
So every night I had to check with her. What are my sessions I'm supposed to? But it was good.
I let you pick a couple.
Yeah, like two. But it was good. I got to go to all the Tula Pink ones, and she went to the technical, how to do taxes.
I had like the unsexy accounting.
That was not fun.
And intellectual property law.
Yeah, I didn't have to do that one.
No.
So anyway,
cool.
All right. So what we're gonna do today is ask questions, which is like stump Pam.
Not really. But if anyone in the audience has a question you didn't get a chance to write down, we will call for those in a bit. So do you want to pull the first question?
No, you go.
Me.
You're in charge. I'm just here. I'm never in charge.
Aaron B asks, "What's your favorite Minecraft character?"
That's really hard.
Because you have no idea.
Because I have no idea about
I am pro Steve. Let me just say. I mean, he's the main character. He's the main dude. Natch. You want to go with him. Now, I do have a second fondness for creepers because they just kind of sidle up to you and then go boom, psh.
So creeper. And I could have called out creepers that way.
I'm kind of a socially creeper. I just kind of sidle up to people and be like,
yeah, like
awkward
at the,
standing.
Like
and
at
boom.
The SoPro convention.
Like at the SoPro convention.
Okay. This is from another young viewer.
Okay.
How do you make the quilts awesome?
Well,
how do you make the quilts awesome? That's a good question.
It is 80% fabric. What's the other 20% that you put in to make it awesome?
I don't know.
It's a math question.
It's a math question. Like, awesomeness is hard to, you know, some quilts are awesome just because they're quilts.
Well, because of technique. I find sometimes it could be a boring quilt, but with a super fabulous name.
Oh, that's a good one. Yeah. Like, it could have a great name. That would be good.
Great name.
Great name. That's how you make it awesome. You name it well.
You'd name it well.
All right.
Do we have a question about how we make it?
I think so.
Oh,
geez. So.
Preview.
So Pam's been shopping Vogue, hints about a book. What's the scoop?
What's the scoop? So I, as we were preparing for SoPro, and normally I've been working on this book, and I tend to work on it on airplanes because I travel quite a bit for my day job. And that's my uninterrupted, I don't have to talk to anyone else on this airplane time.
That's exactly what we did.
So if you listen to my podcast, you have heard me make reference jokingly to this whole Pamming it thing, which started off as a joke in our guild.
Yeah,
whenever
like
anyone got
it.
Anything done quickly, it was like, oh, she Pammed it. And honestly, because when I joined a guild, it was like, oh, show and tell. There's expectation. We show things every month. Oh, gosh, I should finish something every month to show at guild. And I just got in that habit of finishing something to show at every guild meeting.
I show things when they're done.
I finish
maybe
things.
If I
so
want to.
The book is more about,
and I like these people.
Because I have an engineering background, as we know, I love a good spreadsheet, color-coded or not, about what is that process. So I approach things from this process standpoint of, if I can save 2 seconds for every step, over time that adds up. So the book is about, how do you Pam it? How do you, and Pam is an acronym, because yes, I made an acronym out of my own name.
As you do.
Thank goodness it wasn't Pamela, because I've left off the ELA, like whatever, I don't know what that is. So process and achievable moments. So it's about breaking down that process, particularly for younger quilters that have growing families and are still, you know, trying to juggle all these active things. And how do you break that down and what works for you? Because not every quilter is the same, as we've seen.
No.
Not everyone is a giant nerd like
you. You know, but you get, well, honestly,
it's funny,
she gives this lecture at guilds, and it's a great way for those of us who do not understand that process. I have finished quilts faster because I'm friends with you and you make me.
Yes.
She puts me on deadlines. But also the fact that, you know, I've thought about, oh, I've got these things set up and I have, you know, process moments now. And I'm better at it now than I used to be. And it's because of your...
Hooray.
Hooray.
So for those of you that were hoping that I would publish my NaNoWriMo novel from 2010 about the intergalactic crime-solving hairdresser, sorry to disappoint. That one is not going to make it. Maybe on our 25th anniversary of The Stitch,
yeah,
I will do
Stitch.
A live reading of just the prologue is the best part, and then it's like 40,800 words of crap.
So you're writing a book about Pamming it.
Pamming it, yes.
But it's going to be called something else. Like you're not calling it Pamming it.
I don't know
what
I'm calling it yet.
What determines a piece is an original design?
If a piece is an original design.
What determines if a piece... This is like major controversy on the internet webs.
Oh, except in my intellectual property discussion at SoPro, they covered this. Like, what is a derivative work? So the greatest analogy was Harry Potter series as a book series. That is an original work. The movies based on those books are derivative works.
Because they didn't stick to the books?
No, because they were using that original source material, but presenting it in a different media.
So, like, all right, so if I go to the museum and I'm looking at Mona Lisa and I make a quilt that's a derivative work because I'm using a different medium.
Right. So the question is, if you make a churn dash quilt.
A churn dash quilt.
And you saw someone had a great use of color at a quilt show, and you go back and you make your own churn dash quilt, is that a derivative work because you've seen one?
Well, the thing with that is churn dash is a block that's been out for over 100 years.
It's public domain.
And it's public domain.
True.
So it's not like, you know, there's some quilts here where people have done paper piecing and it's very intricate. If I'm reproducing that paper piecing, it's not derivative, it's a copy.
So, ooh, here's a good question. So I have a quilt hanging in the show. It is called Hogwarts Required Reading. That is the castle where the Harry Potter novels are set. So not only is the quilt inspired by the books, it is also using paper piecing designs designed by other people. However, the layout that I use, the addition of what's beyond the bookshelf, is my design.
Right.
Mine is clearly a derivative work.
Derivative work. I you know, people get all, like, there was an article that came out on Modern Quilt Guild, and it was very controversial. There were a lot of people that got up in arms because I don't know that they defined it the same way that
they did not. They said, if you see this particular quilt and you make a quilt inspired by that, you must get permission from the original quilter or pattern designer to then put it in the quilt con show. Now, they have since...
They backtracked.
And then they said, oops, we probably should not make rules without talking to our membership first. Yeah. And so they've been doing a series of
town
halls.
They had a whole town hall thing where you had to do
that. Oh, they still have them. And I think they'll cover it again at QuiltCon in February.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Okay. Next question.
Can I read one?
Yes. Thanks. Here. I was just like pulling
them out. What snacks do you eat while quilting?
What snacks do you eat while quilting? Chocolates. Because I'm a quilter and that's a law. Right? No? Actually, the most common snack I eat while quilting is almonds. Because I don't get a lot
Cheeto
of
dust.
Stuff on my... Cheeto dust doesn't get on the quilt. And I think about that because if I'm snacking while I'm sewing and stuff, I don't want grease and stuff on my hands. So I almonds are usually somewhere in my purse or quilting room. I like almonds.
Carrot sticks.
That requires going to the refrigerator. Almonds I can just leave in my quilting room. I don't leave. I got dogs that are tall.
I got a short
dog.
That
would like find the carrot sticks. And then, yeah, so.
So no Cheetos.
No Cheetos. Anything that's sticky. And I'm even picky about what lotions I use.
Yeah.
Like if the lotions are sticky, you don't want the grease on. Everybody's nodding over here. Yeah. See, these
Your
are my
people
right
Where
here.
Where are my nerds at?
These are my people.
Woo! Right.
Yeah, so I'm even concerned about that.
Okay,
all right,
you're next.
No, you're next.
I'm next. Ooh, two for me.
Yes.
How do you name your quilts? We knew this was coming.
How do I name my quilts? I try to be funny.
Me too.
I want something fun that I name them.
Well, so for our patterns that we design, which for those of you here, you're welcome to buy after we're done filming.
Yeah, exactly.
And in fact, the quilt behind us is Lucky Star. So for the patterns that we've designed, we've named them after pop culture, music, movies, TV shows from primarily the 80s, but we're branching out to other decades. So those come into play that way. So my personal quilts, you know, I had a quilt once that I named Steve because I finished it and I'm like, I have no idea what to name this. I think I'll name it Steve.
I think, you know what? I don't struggle naming the quilts as much as I struggle. Like when you enter it in a quilt show, you have to write a
Your
paragraph.
Artist statement.
Oh my gosh.
I run out of room though.
Like I make Mike come in and read my artist statements all the time. Like, does this make sense?
Like I went to Hawaii.
I don't know. So I made this quilt. It's actually hanging in the show. It was for a challenge for Guild and it was a postcard challenge, or it was a challenge of travel. Where have you traveled? So I made one about Hawaii because I went to Hawaii. And honestly, so all these other people have these quilts of where they traveled and they're giving you these novels of, you know, I visited Italy and we saw these gorgeous tile floors and they had all these intricate patterns and I was inspired by the food and the ambiance and da da da. And it went on for like days and they read mine and went, we went to Hawaii, we had a good time. What else do you need to know? So I am bad at the whole, I have to have somebody else help me write those.
I've run out of room on mine. I'm like, only 100 characters. That's less than a tweet. Curses.
I'm like,
can I use emojis?
I used orange. I don't know what to tell you.
I like fabric.
There you go.
That is my statement.
There's my statement. I made a quilt. You're going to get to
cold,
look at it.
So I made a blanket.
I just am bad at the description.
Fort. Many, many things.
We've already talked about it. I don't know how to do forts.
I will
anyway,
teach you. That will
right,
be a fun
ahead.
Video where I teach Lynn how to make a quilt fort. All right, our next question. Lynn
this
and
looks
Pam.
Hard.
Ooh, two-parter. There's a typo.
Should I read it with the typo?
No.
What is your favorite quilt you've ever made?
My favorite quilt? No.
The favorite quilt that I ever did versus quilt. So what's your favorite quilt?
Favorite quilt I've ever made is Open Doors.
Okay.
Which is a, it's a based on a,
Renee Merrill.
Renee Merrill technique, which is foundation piecing. And it's a 20-inch piece that's got, I don't know, 800-900 pieces in it, because I'm crazy. And then it's got about 80 hours of quilting in it, and it's very intricate. I think we've had it on one of the episodes.
Yes,
that's my favorite quilt.
That's
the one I'm most proud of that I put a ton of time in, you know.
Mine is whatever one I'm not working on currently, because in the middle of every quilt I'm on, I'm like, well, this is horrible, and I hate it. I should set it on fire.
She says that all the time.
I do.
Like, she'll text me, like, I can't believe we're doing this.
Put a calendar reminder 6 months out, never do this quilt again.
Ever again, yeah. And then we get it done, and it's like, oh, my gosh, this is gorgeous. You know?
So
what's your favorite?
So my favorite ones, to me, they're like, I put the time and the money or the investment into it, and they always end up having applique. And I'm like, but I don't consider myself strong in applique.
But you do a nice applique.
Well, it's the Harry Potter quilt that's hanging here.
Oh, she complained about that paper piecing in Harry Potter for,
because it took me a year.
A year.
I could enter nothing in my usage spreadsheet for a year.
It drove her nuts. I'm like, but it's intricate. That's why it's taking you so long. Yeah.
I know. All right.
What's her
second part? Your favorite tunes to sew to?
Hamilton. I listen to Hamilton. I mean, I'm actually starting to judge how long it takes me. The musical Hamilton. If you've not heard the musical Hamilton, go buy it. I've actually judged how long it takes me to do a quilt according to how many times I've listened to Hamilton for that quilt.
It's a three Hamilton quilt.
It's a three Hamilton quilt. Means I've spent, you know, 7.5 hours quilting. Because each time you listen to Hamilton, it's 2.5 hours. So I love Hamilton.
Mark
I'm driving
Watney.
My husband's crazy.
It's like Mark Watney in The Martian, who made up this like measure of energy usage, and he just called it pirate ninjas because he could. So yeah.
Yeah.
How many Hamiltons?
So how many Hamiltons is? So that's gonna be like my new determination of how long it takes to do something. How many Hamiltons did it take you?
So I tend to actually sew while I'm listening to podcasts or books. Perhaps you've heard of Hip to Be a Square Quilting Podcast. I hear it's fabulous. New episode out last week.
Yes.
So if it's not spoken word, I will usually go to Amazon Prime and go to the tempo playlist selection and pick something that's happy and upbeat. So there's a good one called like Songs to Clean To. And some of it, it's like, well,
I don't want to clean while I'm quilting.
No, but you don't, but it's happy, upbeat. It's like up-tempo.
Oh.
And that gets me in
like cleaning and quilting do not go together.
No, I don't actually clean to it.
No.
So haha, joke's on you, Amazon Prime. I do what I want.
Yeah. So that's what you listen to.
Okay. You're next.
All right. So,
can
you give some tips for designing modern quilt for someone who's brand new to modern quilting? Go.
Well, it all starts with how you define modern.
I think so, yeah.
So if you go by the national guidelines, they are very big on the use of negative space and kind of minimalism and a lot of solids. So you can stick to those aesthetics and go for it. And if you think, well, I want to make a turn dash quilt. Okay, don't make a 12 block classic layout, you know, 3x4 layout.
Yeah.
That's
change
not
the
considered
layout.
Change the layout.
Change the size.
Change size.
Like, you know, if you're into
scale.
Making modern, change the scale of the block. Don't make, you know, 12 inch, make 24 inch, make 36 inch, make
just one big turn.
Yeah,
dash.
Exactly. Something like that. Yeah. That makes it modern. Definitely solids, if you're into solids, that's a big deal. A lot of gray. You see a lot of gray in modern quilts.
Yeah, gray is a negative space for the
right.
background. Not
yeah.
so much as like the foreground attention.
And if
like
you are going to use
color.
Prints, I they're more graphic. They're more geometrical. They're more.
Yeah.
They're not as.
Not a lot of florals.
Yeah.
Not a lot of
Dixie like calicos
prints.
Is not.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I don't want to say it's dirty colors, but the brown kind of colors reproduction you don't see in modern
yeah.
stuff.
The muddier tones.
The muddier tones, yeah. They're not dirty, they're muddy.
Okay. Next.
So that's what I would do.
Oh, we already answered that one. That was about my book because I thought we forgot to put it in. Again, not the intergalactic crime-solving hairdresser. Okay. What was your most disastrous quilt project and where is it now?
Most disastrous quilt project? I got a couple. Like, I've made ugly quilts and gave them away. so other people can share in the ugliness.
Just turn it over and look at the back.
Like, oh, that was a bad choice. I probably have some that I haven't quilted yet but finished the top. That.
Oh, so it's in a pile.
Oh, it's in a pile. Yeah, someplace. I did finish one where it was part of the disaster was quilting it. Yeah. So I can't, and I may have told this story. So I was quilting on a long arm and Pam wanted to come over and quilt. So I needed to get this quilt off my long arm. So I was doing really intricate quilting on the, I did a piano key border and was doing really intricate quilting on the piano key. And so I thought, well, if I just do the border and then I get it off, I can come back and quilt the middle. Well, no. On a long arm, that is bad. This is very bad. So I got to the bottom. Once she came over and quilted, I put mine back on, and it had these horrible, like, I was folding up for, I know, it makes you cringe, right? You're just like, ugh. So I did that. But I finished it, and now I've hung it up, and people don't know.
They don't know, because it's not that bad.
But me, I'm like, but look where this is. I show up all the bad parts.
My mom has mine.
Yeah. So
my mom has some great work of mine, and my mom has like a real stinker. Sorry, Mom.
Do you need to give credit to quilt that has inspired you or your designs, especially if they look very similar?
So that to me is something that I would put in a blog post about the quilt. So, yeah. Oh, I finished this quilt. Oh, I was inspired by this one. Now, if I've seen it at a show and photography is not allowed, you can't exactly show like, here's the quilt I looked at, because you shouldn't have been taking that picture.
Right. Yeah.
But I think, you know, when you enter a quilt in a show, many shows will say, is this based on a pattern? Is this an original design?
Right.
And in that space, you need to say like, oh, it came from this pattern or this kit or whatever.
And sometimes you have to get permission from the designers. Yeah. And actually, that determined what quilt I entered in this show. So I had this one quilt I was going to enter here, and I was right, because I'm a deadline girl, so I'm like 30 minutes before they shut it down at midnight. I'm trying to enter a quilt, right? So the one that I had uploaded that I was going to enter, I needed to get permission from the designer, and I was like, well, can't enter that one. So I entered a double wedding ring because I didn't have to get permission for that. Because double wedding rings have been out for a long time and it doesn't matter. So, cool. Yes, you should get permission from designers.
I think so, yeah. If it's a wild, like, a difference from it, where you know the inspiration, like birds. I mean,
yeah,
that's kind of broad.
Yeah.
But I think it depends on... If you are just making a quilt for your own use, no, I don't think so. If you're hanging it in a show, it depends on the rules of the
right.
show.
Right, yeah, it depends on the rules of the show.
All right, so. We have two questions left, and then we'll take live audience questions.
Go.
Me? Okay. That's
right. I think I asked the last one.
Okay. Talk about the parking deck photos.
All right, so if you followed us on Instagram, we were at SoPro, and when we were walking through the parking deck, they were painting all of these famous artworks as spoofs on the sides of the parking deck. So Pam and I decided it'd be fun to pose in front of all of them. So we have posed in front of...
American Gothic.
Heck yeah.
I don't think the Egyptian one was an
the
actual...
The Egyptian one I didn't pose yet.
It was just like a Sphinx.
So we did
That's
Egyptian
up.
And, yeah.
Vitruvian Man I did.
Yes.
The Art Nouveau.
The Art Nouveau
we,
I did.
We were like, okay.
Oh, Sunday in the Park. We did Sunday
convention,
in the Park.
The convention was over Saturday, and we are just like giddy on introvert delirium of like, we've been talking to people for 3 days. Let's go not talk to people. So we're walking through the deck. And like, this would be great.
So we took pictures.
So
it was fun.
More. Yeah.
Yeah, there's a couple more we got to.
All right.
Oh, and then I Want You, the U.S.
Oh, yeah.
That's got to go out today. All right. Do you have any great suggestions for brand new program director for a local guild? Oh, that's tough. I feel for these. I mean, we will be happy to come talk to your guilds. So please hire us. We do programs, but I think that that's a tough thing because I think the person who schedules programs for guilds, that's a tough job. And what makes it interesting is like you're hiring these people sometimes a year or two out,
yeah.
And you're done with the job before the next person gets that
Inherits
put in their
it.
Plate, you know, 2 years later. So I get that it's tough, but I like to see a mix when at least the guilds that I'm involved in, especially if they're really broad guilds. that you would hire people that do hand quilting and some that do paper piecing and some that do applique and some that do, you know, we have a broad range of different skill sets and different styles. I mean, I still want to see reproduction stuff, even though it's not my aesthetic. I appreciate it. And those are gorgeous quilts. I'm just not going to make them. You know, God, I don't have that fabric.
You know, honestly, to me, the easiest thing is like ask the members. Hey,
yeah, what do you guys
want?
What
do we not have?
Do you want an art quilter? Do you want to, yeah. But go to shows, see what people are signing up for. Like if there are shows in your area that have classes, what classes fill up the fastest? Because those are going to be teachers that are interesting to hear and interesting to see. And because people are taking their classes. So I think that's a good way to look at it.
Honestly, for the Modern Guild that we're in, the Atlanta Modern Quilters Guild, a lot of it comes from like, what skills do our members have? Where who shows something awesome at show and tell frequently? And everyone's like, tell me how you did that.
Yeah.
Have them speak.
Have them speak or have somebody do that technique. Yeah. Kind of thing. So.
Okay.
All right. So audience questions.
Do we have any live audience questions?
Questions?
Oh, we have a question. Gentleman in the front.
Yeah, so your head's down, quilting in the zone. What is the best approach for the husband and or significant other to not startle?
Throw chocolate. Wraps.
Okay, the question is just to make sure if someone is quilting and they're in the quilting zone, how does someone approach them without like scaring them? And the reason this question is asked, because this is a common occurrence in our house. Like my husband will come up behind me and I'll be quilting, you know, and I'm in it, doing my Hamilton thing, and all of a sudden his hand's there, and I'm like, whoa! We gotta take out all those stitches. So how do you do it? I've told Mike to turn on and off the lights in the room. That kind of flickers and lets me know something's coming.
It doesn't always work, by the way.
It doesn't always work.
Based on the legends I've heard.
You know, it doesn't. I don't have a great answer to that because I get so, like, I'm zoned.
So my husband doesn't enter the room when I'm doing it. He, like, hollers from behind me, and I'm like, dude, I am listening to music. I can't hear you.
Yeah.
That's cute. Yeah. But a cat will, like, jump up.
Yeah. See, I don't have the whole cat thing jumping up because I'm
So there's no good way. So just save it until we're done.
Just, I like the light thing, but maybe not.
Sit on.
Anybody else have any other questions?
Alrighty. Question from the side.
What's in the future for you
two?
Future? So, during our pajama party business meeting at SoPro, because we were sharing a room.
Yeah.
And there's a picture of that on our Instagram feed. We kind of mapped out a 3-year vision. So, we've got my book is, I'm targeted to finish writing it this year. It's on my spreadsheet. And publish it next year, self-publishing. We are going to continue to do independent pattern design. When we first started, we were so cute. We're like, we're going to do one a month. It's going to be awesome. And then we're like, holy moly, that's bananas. No.
Oh, my gosh.
Now, having said that, we had a new pattern come out this month. You spin me right round. Feel free to place an online order. Lucky Star is coming out in print. Right now, it was exclusive to a quilt shop. We are putting that up for online orders or in-person orders here at the show. So we've had those two back to back, and I think we're aiming for like one or two independent patterns a quarter. So for the year, that would be 6 to 8 new quilt patterns. We are collaborating on a book, which really draws on how she and I work together and our differences between, you know, process and art. Some of us may have taken classes about fabric design while at SoPro. Some of us not named Pam, because I'm like, it's going to be a lot of straight lines. And maybe it'll be a line of solids.
I came out of a class going, we should design fabric.
And I'm like,
and Pam's like, like, oh my God.
And I'm like, my daughter's good at drawing. I'll ask her to do some.
So, you know, that's kind of an out there vision.
That's way long term. In terms of the show, we're sticking with 2 episodes a month. My podcast, which comes out Fridays, you know, it's being, when the show episodes come out, we post the audio only on there. That's going to continue. And so I'm figuring out, like, what does that need to be, that audio cadence?
Right. And the next thing we're doing, and it's kind of...
Well, I don't think we should reveal it. But we have an idea for another video segment that we want to introduce.
Right.
So we've got the virtual stitch-ins, which are kind of the middle of the month, and then our episode, the mid-month episode, comes out. And then we've got an end-of-the-month episode. And then we've got audio in between. We have an idea for another video segment to be maybe first Friday of the month. And we need to get some of those in the bank before we start talking about those and promoting them.
Right.
We also hope to be speaking at many local guilds.
Yes.
Gentlemen that Aunt asked.
Yeah. All right. Any other questions?
Okay. Well, we are going to take a break. So for those of you watching on YouTube, you'll see some close-ups of Lucky Star behind us in Lynn's gorgeous quilting. And we are going to bring in a special guest.
Yay.
So give us a few minutes here live, and we will be back shortly.
Now we're joined by a special guest, Frances O'Roark Dowell, who will be joining us to talk about her new quilt novel, Birds in the Air.
So I've known Frances for years through a quilting podcast, and as the author of many books I encourage my own kids to read, her podcast, The Off-Kilter Quilt, is a charming perspective on real-life quilting, and she's won several awards for her middle grade novels, including the Edgar Award and the William Allen White Children's Book Award. So, Frances, how are you?
I am good. I am excited to be on my favorite quilt TV show.
Yay!
Yes, no, I think this is just such an amazing, exciting project. And I'm so glad you're doing it. We needed it. We need you.
Thank you. Good. Yay.
Yeah, so I'm good.
So tell us about your book.
Well, this is my book. It's called Birds in the Air. It is a novel about a woman who never knew she wanted to be a quilter and then is sucked into the cult. Yes, which happens. Her name is Emma Bird, and she is in her early 40s. She lives with her family in Chapel Hill, North Carolina, which is kind of like this area, growing, developing, big. And she and her family move up to the mountains of Western North Carolina to a small town seeking the simple life, which they discover really doesn't exist because it doesn't exist.
Yeah.
But one of the great things, and this was so fun as a writer, Emma finds a quilt in the attic of the old house they bought, which is a dream. Like, I bought an old house. It's got a trunk in the attic. And look, a quilt. But she doesn't know anything about quilts. And actually, one of the things, when she moves up to the mountains, she hopes she's going to become a writer. And she keeps procrastinating on that project. So finding the quilt gives her one more way to procrastinate. She takes it to the local quilt shop that this small town just happens to have to find out what kind of quilt. It's clearly old. What kind? What's this quilt about? And the shop owner talks to her about the quilt and says, okay, now it's time for you to make a quilt. And then it's like, don't do that. Can't do that. Never thought about doing that. And, of course, walks out of the quilt shop with hundreds of dollars worth of quilting supplies.
As you do.
As one does.
As one does.
It's worse than Target, quite frankly.
No, you're right.
Yeah, and then she becomes a quilter and becomes involved with the local guild, and it's kind of how she finds community. Lots of bumps and, you know, dead ends and what have you. But it's really, that's where she finds community in the small town.
That's so us. I mean, I love all the community. I mean, I think that's what we're about.
Yeah, I do too.
So is your quilting journey similar to Emma's?
It is. I'm a midlife quilter. I started quilting, this is sad. I can't remember if Emma's 42 or 43, but I started about 10 years ago. I don't know. I'm 52, so I remember nothing.
Right, okay.
But I started in my early 40s. Unlike Emma, I'd always wanted to make a quilt. Like Emma, totally math phobic. I'm sorry. I know, and I have.
But that's why there's nerds.
Pam. I email Pam with math questions, and she doesn't mock me, which I
No, Pam's good at that.
I did mock Allison Rose, and she's like, "How do you do da da da?" And I did that video on Twitter. Yeah. Let me Google that for you.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I hope I ask you. I don't ask you like percentage questions. You can Google percentages. Yeah. But just that start, and also Emma kind of goes 0 to 60 on the quilt team. total non-quilter, suddenly she's buying a used Bernina. You know, it's like,
and that is not
that's what
an inexpensive investment.
It's not. It's not. So, but she wants to actually buy a cheat machine, and her husband's an engineer, and he's like, he's not. Yeah, no. If we're gonna do this, and so yeah, so she gets, but she gets totally involved, and that's what happened to me. And one of the interesting things to me, as someone who's now quilted for 10 years, is like thinking about all the things I did not understand about quilting before I quilted. I didn't understand you could quilt using a machine. I didn't know anything about it, so I just sort of stumbled into it. And I think, like Emma, my first quilts, I just thought they were amazing. I just, this is so good. And then you go like to a guild meeting, and you're like, oh, this is not amazing.
But I think everybody has to start somewhere. So yeah. I mean, that's a part of the journey of quilting. That makes sense.
I think so. And my latest thing, I feel like we should have affection for our quilts, because
we
tend to be to judge our quilts so much more harshly than other
people's
quilts.
Oh, I'm my worst judge.
I look at that quilt and I'm like, bless its heart.
Bless its heart. It wanted to live so much famous, but
exactly.
It doesn't.
It wanted a better life, and I couldn't give. But yeah. But anyway, but she, I think that she takes her first quilt top, I think, to a guild meeting and hides it under the chair when she sees other. Somebody shows a Dear Jane quilt, the first quilt out.
And oh, my gosh.
Like,
TJ, you know, that's on my bucket list of, you know, like, you got a bucket list of things I want to do that you can do, and then you have a bucket list of like, oh yeah, that's never going to happen, but I should put it on there. Like, we're going to pretend.
Yeah.
That's
yeah,
a good
thing.
About
a hot minute.
I think as my eyes also get worse, I'm like, what are you thinking about? You're going to do these tiny
little.
And they're not even,
No, those are hard.
Okay. Okay, so one of my favorite parts of the book, Emma's like, I've made quilts. I've been quilting for 2 months. I'm going to teach a new friend of mine how to quilt. Have you ever had the delusion of grandeur of like, I shall teach. It will be my calling.
Well, only on the small scale, and only with people who like have never even sewn. Because I feel like, okay, I've got something on someone who's never used a sewing machine, which is actually a fair number of people. One time, though, I have a neighbor who, she wanted to make a quilt for her daughter for college, and she said, can you help? And I said, well, sure. And she, like, she borrowed my sewing machine, and she was, you know, just, and she had these beautiful fabrics, none of which were cotton. And she had this very elaborate, and I actually amazingly helped her come up with a pattern. And she had enough, I think, native talent, but I had gone into that project going, yeah, sure, we'll sew some squares together. This is
going to
be fun. And it was like the Taj Mahal of quilts. I had to keep running. I'm like, I'll be right back. I have to go look something up. So, yeah.
The Googles.
Yeah.
The Googles.
So that was a little terrifying, because I think, because when you quilt, people assume you are a genius, first of all, just because you can make a quilt that is something so few people, it's perceived that so few people
do. Yeah, I agree.
More people do than we realize. But also, that, oh my goodness, you can make a quilt. Well, then let's go work on this double wedding ring I saw in a magazine. You can do that, right? And like, no, I can't.
I love it. People always go, I need a double wedding ring. You're like, oh Lord, that's hard.
Yeah.
That's just hard. So,
but I'm more comfortable like with people under the age of 12. I feel very confident with that. But yes, early on. And that's the thing. I mean, quilting, I think if you get really into it, you can move pretty quickly from a place of being a beginner to advanced beginner. Once you learn, like, quarter-inch seams are good.
Right, and important.
Know? And you kind of let go of huge perfectionist tendencies and just have fun with it. You can really I've never conquered the half-quarter triangle completely, but once you get to that territory, there's a lot you can do.
Yeah, I agree.
You can get to that place pretty quickly.
So yeah, I agree.
I was listening to Vicki Holloway's new podcast. My Creative Corner 3.
Yes.
It's a new one, and it's wonderful. But she was asking about, should I teach this class? I'm thinking about teaching that class. And the idea of like going into a shop and teaching, I mean, it would be laughable. And not because I can't make good quilts, but one, I'm not good at explaining things. I'm left-handed. Let's just leave it at that. I'm left-handed. Well, you're left-handed.
I am left-handed.
But you're math left-handed. I'm art left-handed.
But I teach bag classes, and I've done some like free motion quilting, and then when I think of it as, I'm like, why don't you understand this? I just showed it to you. Like,
right.
What's your problem?
Right.
You didn't just see it and just absorb it.
And so, I would just, I for me, because also I make stuff up as I go along, you know, and that's the thing too. Oh, I don't quite have to do this. Okay, I'll just make this up, you know, which is why.
That's what gets me in writing patterns, because I'm like you.
Yeah.
I just kind of make stuff up, and then she's like, but you need to tell people how you did it.
Yeah, that,
like, just be like, here's a picture of a quilt.
Why do I need to tell people?
I just kind of did this. And then I just did, you know, with the machine. But
I just cut it. I don't know what number.
No.
No. So, that's what. So in some ways, I'm not sure that I would be, or I would forget, or, so I'm not sure I'm made for teaching beyond, you know, here's a quarter-inch seam, here's how you feed the fabric through the, the throat or whatever.
But quarter-inch seams are good. I don't care what you're doing. Got to have a quarter-inch seam.
I can do that. I can. We want to do a quarter-inch seam class?
People need to know.
Yeah, they do.
People need to know, yeah.
Because that was something I didn't know. When I first started quilting, I was just kind of making it up.
I went by the edge of my presser foot, which I think is closer to 3/8.
Yeah, I did that too. I also cut out, I didn't know how to use rulers, and so I just did corn flakes boxes. I cut out templates for squares and triangles and cut them out. And
it worked.
And it worked. Except that I kept cutting. I had a rotary cutter. So each time I cut, I would shave a little stuff. So the squares were getting smaller.
And they started getting.
But I'm happy to make stuff up. Because sometimes that's the only way I can finish anything.
So where can you find your books?
Right now, you can find them online. You can find them at Amazon, Barnes & Noble, any online space. We've just gotten a deal. Ingram is just starting to ship out some books, so we're hoping they'll be in stores. And if you're thinking, well, I'm on a tight budget, although I should say right now there's a Kindle deal, $2.99, little commercial there. You could also, you know, go to your library and ask them to order it.
Oh, good.
That would be great. I mean, I would love to see it in libraries. But right now, online, go to Amazon. And
okay.
We'll have a link to that in our show notes.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So, thanks for asking.
Yeah. Well, it's important. That's. Yeah. I didn't get as far into it as Pam did,
I kept her on a deadline.
She did. But I really like it.
That's why you need nerds.
But it just came out 3 days ago, so it's
not like you've had weeks and weeks. Yeah. It just came out. So. Well, you have some sort of Pam app that comes out with the book, so you can give people deadlines or do have spreadsheets.
Yeah. I gotta talk to the bigger nerd than me about app design.
Wouldn't that be a great idea?
Yeah, we do have a nerd app person.
Yeah.
And that's sitting behind
the Pam in it.
Yeah. So.
Yes.
All right.
Yes.
So maybe.
Okay.
That's on the 3-year plan.
I like it. I think you should.
Some spreadsheet.
Well, gosh, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for
and to be the first
me.
Official guest on the Stitch TV show.
I'm so excited.
That is exciting right there. I'm thrilled.
Yeah.
Thanks so much. This has been fun.
Yeah.
So that's it for today's episode. Today's show could not happen without 77 Peaches Enterprises, your one-stop shop for creative support. We'd like to thank 77 Peaches, Big Think Productions, Cotton Art Studio, and Hip to Be a Square, and also the Off-Kilter Quilt for being part of The Stitch. You can find links to their sites on our show site, thestitchtvshow.com. If you're interested in sponsoring the show, please email us at info@thestitchtvshow.com.
Well, that's all we've got for this episode. If you've enjoyed the show, please like us on YouTube, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, Google Hangout, and share it with your friends.
The next virtual sew-in is Friday, October 14th at 7 p.m. U.S. Eastern, broadcast on our channel here on YouTube and on Google+. My podcast, Hip to Be a Square, will be on every Friday.
And you can email us with any questions or comments at info@thestitchtvshow.com and buy our patterns at shop.thestitchtvshow.com.
All those details and more can be found on our website, guess where?
TheStitchTVShow.com.
Tune in next time for more Quilting Chat with Friends.
Yay.
We survived.